Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. And we are on lesson 24 of our study of the book of Ephesians, living in union with Christ. And this time around, we're going to be looking at chapter 6, verses 5 to 9. We're going to be looking at servants and masters in union with Christ. I hope that's a provocative title. It's going to be interesting as we go through to see how this works out in light of our union with Christ. But I hope to bring some of those things, some of those thoughts out. Ephesians 6, beginning at verse 5. And remember the context. The context has been marriage, wives, husbands, and family, children, parents. And now we come to bond servants and masters in that same context of the household. Bond servants, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in sincerity of heart as to Christ, not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bond servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. And you, masters, do the same things to them, giving up threatening, knowing that your own master also is in heaven, and there is no partiality with him. Okay, let us pray. Our gracious God and Father, we thank you for this portion of your word. We thank you that as we come to this portion of your word, we understand that you are a God who has brought us into saving union with yourself through the Lord Jesus Christ. As we have believed on him and as we have repented of our sins, we thank you, O Lord, that you have given to us your word and that you have spoken to us those things that are true and for our salvation and for our sanctification. And Lord, we pray that you'd help us to understand this portion of your word, which seems in some ways so distant and foreign to us. But help us to draw principles from this portion of your word as well, and help us to understand what you are saying to us through this part of the Holy Scriptures. We ask you, Father, that you would forgive us our sins and that you would help us to understand these things, to receive them with all of our hearts, and to live in this world as those in union with our Savior Jesus Christ. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so the theme of the book that we've been looking at, the theme of Ephesians, is union with Christ. So we've been looking at the whole book, every passage that we've come to, we've been looking at under that theme of union with Christ. God has brought us into union and communion with himself through the blood of Jesus Christ, through the salvation that we have in him. And then every section of this book we've been looking at in light of that theme. Last time we looked at the life in union, or we looked at how life in union with Christ is a life that transforms families and households. Now, backing up two lessons, we looked at the relationship between husbands and wives, beginning with wives and then with husbands. And we looked at how the marriage relationship is central, and we really can't begin to understand family life at all unless we begin to understand the marriage relationship. And then we began to look at families, and we began to look at the place of children. And that's what we looked at last time. Children and their responsibility in the covenant. We saw how God actually speaks to children. And that really should encourage the hearts of the children of the congregation as they understand that they too are in covenant with God, and they too are called saints of the Most High God. They too are addressed by God at the very beginning of this letter. And then we looked at parents, and especially fathers. And it's important to see that God's word particularly addresses fathers. It particularly addresses fathers as those who have the responsibility in the household, at least in what is regarded as the typical Christian household. Now, that's not necessarily going to be the case in every instance that there's going to be a father in the home. But where there is a father, certainly the father is being addressed most particularly. And the responsibility on the father is to raise the children, his children, in the training and admonition of the Lord. Now, that's a responsibility for fathers and mothers, but mothers are addressed, in this section at least, through their husbands. So it's important to see the great responsibility that God places on fathers in their role as heads of household. And then the last thing we looked at was some practical instructions for parents, and we had a number of things that flowed out of that passage as we tried to understand what does it mean to raise children in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. What does it mean to be people who have taken vows, if we have children who have taken vows, to raise our children in that way? So that brings us then to our section tonight, verses 5 through 9. And I think what the most startling thing about this next section is where it falls in Paul's teaching. I've already mentioned that. Paul's dealt with the closest of human relationships. He's dealt with the relationship between husbands and wives. He's dealt with the relationship between parents and children. So these are the closest, even natural and earthly relationships that we can have, even apart from what the covenant does and what the Spirit does in those relationships. But now he's going to turn his attention to those relationships that are perhaps the most strained and even unnatural. And that's, I think that's important for us to see, that he deals with that immediately after he deals with the relationship between husbands and wives and parents and children. He deals with other members of the household in those days. And oftentimes, those members of the household would be slaves. The word here is not a different word from the ordinary word for slaves. It is the word slave, and so we have to confront this, or we have to be confronted by this portion of God's word and understand what it's saying to us. As we know, the country that we live in has a long and complicated history. We're not the only country in the world that has a long and complicated history, a history in our country that can't be told apart from the history and the practice of slavery. But I think it's important for us to stay focused on what Scripture says to us. And Paul's not going to address slavery at this point in order to directly condemn it. That's not his purpose here. He's not seeking to directly condemn slavery. He does condemn it, but I would say he does so indirectly by way of preaching the gospel. And he does it here, and he does it elsewhere. So slavery is condemned, but indirectly through the preaching of the gospel. We'll talk more about that in a few moments. The concern here, the concern in a society, the society of the Roman Empire that had perhaps 60 million slaves at that time, was perhaps 25-30% of the population were in slavery. So that's a huge percentage of the population that were slaves. And his concern is to teach servants and masters, Christian servants and Christian masters, how to relate to one another as brothers and sisters in Christ. That's the concern of Paul in this section. In doing so, he really wants to show how the gospel transforms hearts and how the gospel sets men and women free, even perhaps when their bodies are in chains. And so for Paul, the big issue here is not liberty it's not political liberty, let me say. It's spiritual liberty. That's the big issue for Paul. He wants to show what is possible when the gospel sets both slaves and masters free and then brings them together into the body of Christ where they're on an equal playing field and they're called to love one another as brothers and sisters in the Lord. Now, that's an amazing thing. And we'll get more to that in a moment. So we want to look at two things this evening. First, we want to look at what the gospel says to servants, verses 5 to 8. And then we want to look at what the gospel says to masters in verse 9. So what does the gospel say to servants? And the first thing we want to look at is the calling of bond servants, or the calling of slaves. Now, in the Old Testament, there was a particular kind of slave called a bond servant, a willing servant, one who would have said that he wanted to serve his master all his days. And this was one kind of slavery that was actually permissible in Israel. But we're not talking about that kind of bond servant. So don't get those two words confused. The word here is the ordinary, typical Greek word doulos for servant or slave. And it does have a range of meaning. It can mean a willing servant. But here, certainly the meaning is in context. It's the meaning of the slave, the one who's in bondage to another. And so our tendency when we come to a passage like this, especially if we're kind of feeling a little bit uncomfortable with what the scriptures say, and given the history in our own country and given the cultural context that we live in and all of those things, our tendency when we come to a passage like this is to jump immediately to application, to skip over the meaning in the original context and to skip right to application. So we start talking about employees and employers and that sort of thing. So we change bond servants to employees and we change masters to employers. Now I'm going to argue, or I'm just going to say that I think that that's not really a healthy impulse for us to do, because we're going to miss a lot when we do that. When we just try to shift gears and start looking at this from a 21st century perspective. There is that application to be made. And certainly we will live in our employer-employee and employee-employer relationships. We'll live differently. But that's not the primary thing that's being addressed here. So we want to see what Paul is saying to us and what God's Word is saying. So what's Paul doing? He's addressing the church, but the church cannot help but to exist within a cultural structure, a cultural infrastructure, a cultural architecture. Every church exists within a society. That society has a particular culture. We may like it, we may not like it, but the point is that the church that Paul is addressing, the church at Ephesus, existed within a particular cultural structure at a particular point in time. And so the focus that Paul has is not on changing Roman society. It's not on changing Roman culture. He's not seeking to start an abolition campaign. That's not his primary focus. Now, you may begin to draw out principles from the text that would lead you in that direction in your thinking, and I think you should. But what I'm saying here is that that's not what Paul is really driving at here. What he's really saying is that through the preaching of the gospel, both slaves and masters have been set free to newness of life in Christ. And that's happening in the very same church. Look with me at verse 5. Bondservants, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in sincerity of heart, as to Christ. Well, that's addressing bondservants and what their responsibility is, but Paul doesn't just address bondservants. He addresses masters as well. And these are masters in the church. So these are Christian masters, Christian slave owners. Now that probably to us seems like an oxymoron. Seems like something, two things that can't possibly go together. But here we have it in the Word of God. It's very interesting. Now remember, this is the first generation of New Testament Christianity. I mean, this is the gospel is brand new, and so people are learning how to be Christians, and that, as you know, and as I know, that doesn't happen overnight. And so Paul is, you might say, he's working with the material that he has in the context that he has it. And so what's really startling, or should be startling to us, I think, is not the fact that he's addressing masters of slaves, even as Christians, but I think what should be startling to us is how countercultural this section of Ephesians actually is. It's very countercultural, because we miss the point if we say, oh no, Paul is failing to address the social evil of slavery. Well, the truth is that he actually does address it. Maybe not how we would expect him to address it, but he absolutely does address it. Listen to Ian Hamilton. Ian Hamilton says this: in the context of the middle years of the first century AD, it's remarkable that Paul should have specifically addressed slaves, along with wives, husbands, parents, children, and masters. No less than these other groups, slaves belonged to the church. That's countercultural. You see, Paul is saying what society was unwilling to say. Paul is saying something that society will not say. Society at that time would never have said that that slaves were on equal footing socially as masters. But in the church, Paul is saying that's absolutely the case. There's no slave, there's no free. We're all one in Christ Jesus. That's absolutely countercultural for this time. And so Paul is addressing the church. Paul is addressing saints. That takes us back to chapter 1. Verse 1. And as I said, what's startling to us is that he includes both masters and slaves in that category as members of the church, as saints. He's addressing both. He's got things to say to both, but he is including both in the same category. Now, that's a remarkable thing for us to think about. It would have been remarkable back then, too. For different reasons, though. You see, whatever that does to our sensibilities, it's the Word of God. If we're surprised to hear God addressing children in the Word of God, and that would have been very surprising in the Roman context, that would have been absolutely unthinkable in a Roman context to hear God addressing children directly. How much more that God would address slaves, or that God would address masters, and that God would address both in the same breath. You see, this is the gospel at work. This is amazing. And really what's most shocking here, I think, is that the gospel has brought both of these together, the slave and the master, in the same spiritual household, and put them on the same spiritual plane. You see, socially, in terms of Roman society, there's a vast difference. But when they come into the church, they're on the same spiritual plane. That's revolutionary. And that really is going to, over time, and really it's going to take a long time for these principles to work themselves out, and for the salt and light to work itself out into different societies. And there's an ebbing and a flowing, and in some societies there's a going backwards and then a going back in the other direction. But the point I'm trying to make is that these that is the very that principle is what undermines the whole institution of slavery in the first place. The idea that spiritually, before God, they are on the same spiritual plane. So it's shocking. It's really shocking when you think about it. They are both fellow citizens, as we've already heard, with the saints and members of the household of God. Ephesians 2:19. So the slaves and the masters are being addressed as fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. And one of the things that the gospel is teaching the Ephesians long ago and is teaching us is that the gospel knows no social barriers and no special social privileges. We enjoy the same privileges before God, which is a wonderful thing. The same access to Christ, the same forgiveness of sins, the same union and communion with God. All of these privileges that we've already talked about, that we've already seen in the book of Ephesians, all of them belong to the saints. And the remarkable thing is that these two categories of people who naturally would be at enmity with one another, just as Jew and Gentile would be at enmity with one another, slave and free would also be at enmity with one another, and God has brought them together in the household of faith. So the issue is not here the issue of social justice or the issue of political liberty. The issue, the big issue, is the spiritual issue. It is what God has done to bring them together into one body, to make them a spiritual family, to make them members of Christ and members of one another. And how that works itself out in history and in political theory and in societies throughout the world, it's going to look different in different times and different ages. And we might have all kinds of different ideas about what the ideal might be, but no one has ever lived in the ideal political society. That hasn't happened yet. It's coming, but it hasn't happened yet. It's coming when Jesus returns. So, what's the calling of servants? What's the calling of slaves? And slaves are addressed first, just as wives were addressed first, children were addressed first. In this section, slaves are addressed first. The one in submission to authority is the one who's addressed first. The calling of servants in union with Christ is to obey their earthly masters as those who are first of all slaves of Jesus Christ. Not to rebel against them, not to decide for themselves when to obey and when not to obey, but their calling as witnesses of the resurrection of Jesus Christ is to obey their earthly masters as those who are first of all slaves of Jesus Christ. That's consistent with the teaching of the rest of the New Testament. So if you were to go over to, for instance, if you were to go over to Colossians chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, verse 22, it says, I'm in Philippians, so that's not going to help. Colossians 3, verse 22. Verse 22, it says, "Bondservants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in sincerity of heart, fearing God." So basically the same thing. Colossians in many ways echoes Ephesians. You see the same thing in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 6. And verse 1, "Let as many bondservants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor." And here's the reason: so that the name of God and his doctrine may not be blaspheming. blasphemed. And then, but it goes on, and those who have believing masters, let them not despise them because they are brethren, but rather serve them because those who are benefited are believers and beloved. Teach and exhort these things. So a believing slave was called upon by God, from this portion of his word, was called upon to give even more diligence in serving a believing master, because he was a brother in the Lord. And then Titus, chapter 2, verse 9. It says, exhort bondservants. So this is, Titus is a minister of the gospel, and Titus is being taught by the Apostle Paul what to teach and how to teach. He says, exhort bondservants to be obedient to their own masters, to be well-pleasing in all things, not answering back, not pilfering, not stealing, but showing all good fidelity, that they may adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. Again, it's the idea of being a witness of the gospel, showing that the gospel is actually able to transform hearts and lives, and to produce in produce in one under even under a harsh kind of servitude, to produce a heavenly disposition, even in those circumstances. And then finally, 1 Peter, we have a similar exhortation. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18. Servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. For this is commendable if, because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it if, when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. And he goes on to give the example of Christ, who was the perfect bondservant, who submitted himself to all sorts of indignities and humiliation for our sake. This is a radical teaching. It's a radical teaching. Now, it sounds radical to us for different reasons than it would have sounded radical back then. But it's radical. It's completely new. It's completely unheard of in the ancient world, this teaching. In the Roman world, Ian Hamilton says, in the Roman world, three words dominated. Caesar, ipsi, dixit. Caesar has spoken. And people were to respond to that by saying, Caesar is Lord. In other words, a deification of the emperor, a deification of the state, and the Christian was often called upon to stand against that and to say, Christ is Lord. But Ian Hamilton goes on to say, Caesar was undisputed Lord and Master. But for Christians, there was but one Lord and one Master, Jesus Christ. Every Christian, whether slave or free, owed their first and fundamental allegiance to him and to no other. And what's so radical about this teaching is that the gospel has set both slaves and masters free to serve Christ rather than men. That's the radical nature of this teaching. So that they could continue in whatever estate they were in, and Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, if you're a slave and you have the opportunity to be free, use it. Make use of it. Get out of that estate if there's any way that you possibly can. In Rome, you actually oftentimes would have the possibility, if you had the money to do it, you could buy yourself out of slavery, or someone else could buy you out of slavery. Not true in American slavery. So at least there was that sort of outlet there. And Paul is saying, make use of that. make use of that. But understand that this is a radical teaching in the ancient world, a teaching that is focused on our spiritual obligation to manifest the heavenly character of the life of the world to come in this world. And so what happens is people begin to live in a way that's just absolutely unthinkable to the world around us. I'm hearing somebody's got a microphone that's on, so I'm hearing some background noise. Thank you. Sorry. If you need to ask a question or something like that, just let me know. Okay, so we're seeing the calling, or we saw the calling of bondservants. What's the gospel logic of the calling of bondservants? I should have mentioned this. The notes are available. The notes are available on the website. So if you need to pull those up, they're available on the homepage of the website. So what's the gospel logic? The gospel logic of the calling of bondservants. Paul wants Christian slaves to see that their freedom in Christ does not dissolve the bonds of slavery imposed by human society. Let me say that again. Paul wants Christian slaves to see that their freedom in Christ does not dissolve the bonds of slavery imposed by human society. Again, this passage is not directly seeking to... it's not a passage that is promoting societal change and cultural change directly. I think it does indirectly, but not directly. Paul, he knows how things are in Roman society. He's endured much. He's a Roman citizen, but he knows how things are in Roman society, and he knows what can happen if you get on the wrong side of authority in Roman society. His goal is not social. His goal is not cultural. His goal is not political. He's not fundamentally seeking social change. He's seeking spiritual change. He's seeking spiritual transformation. He's neither condemning or condoning the Roman social system. If he did that, and this is helpful for us today to think about. If Paul was condemning or condoning the Roman system, he would have much more to do than condemn slavery. If we just take the condemning side of it, he would have much more to do than condemn slavery. There'd be so many other things that he'd have to condemn. And he'd spend all his time condemning the evils of Roman society, and he'd be so distracted by that that he'd never get around to proclaiming the gospel. That's not his purpose here. His purpose is not to condone or condemn slavery. Otherwise, he'd be doing nothing else. That's all he would have. And you see that sometimes when I'm not saying a minister should never have any kind of interaction with politics or society or culture. I'm not saying that. But sometimes you see that can consume people, and it distracts them from the fundamental calling that they have in proclaiming the gospel. There's plenty to do in proclaiming the gospel, discipling the sheep, and ministering to people, shepherding people, that will consume your life. Becoming a social activist is definitely on the low list of priorities. Paul's goal is to teach Christians how to live in a manner that will exalt Christ and bear witness of his glory. That's his purpose. He's seeking to teach Christians how to live in a manner that will exalt Christ and will bear witness of the resurrection glory of Christ. And so the obedience of slaves to masters is to be a certain kind of obedience. Let me get back into Ephesians here. Okay, so to be a certain kind of obedience. Not with eye service as men pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ. And then he says in verse 7, with goodwill during service as to the Lord and not to men. And it's with fear and trembling. I skipped over that, but it's with fear and trembling. That same phrase is used in Philippians 2:12. With fear and trembling. In fact, I should just turn there for a moment and read that. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. It's the same phrase that's used there of the Christian's service to Christ. And so the Christian's service to his earthly master is to be regarded in the first century as the Christian's service to Jesus Christ, as an aspect of the Christian's service to Jesus Christ. And so a Christian slave would have known, if he knew the gospel, he would have known that he is worthy of a far worse condition than slavery. He sees his service in relation to Christ. Now, this came home to me in particular as I was, as all of you know, and whoever may watch this video later, you may or may not know, but as I spent many years in prison for a crime that I committed, but I actually was a slave. Now, it was a legal form of slavery. It was actually a constitutional form of slavery. It's actually a form of slavery that is permissible. I was not paid for my labor. I was working in cotton fields. I was picking cottons. I was picking all sorts of crops, and I was essentially paying my debt to society in that way. I was literally a slave. And there were guards that had guns, and you know, it was really, really hard in that environment to work, to do my work with a cheerful heart. And the Lord, because I wasn't getting paid, there was no reward. There was absolutely no reward other than the food that I ate. And so I had to learn in that context literally what it means to be in slavery and to do my work as unto the Lord. Not for the guard who is on horseback with a gun, but to do my work for the Lord. Not to do my work for the other prisoners who may want me to move faster, some of them, or who may want me to move slower and were getting mad at me if I'm going too fast. No, I needed to do my work for the Lord and to please him. That was a lesson that took years and years, and I'm sure if I was still there, I'd still be learning that lesson. But that's the kind of mindset that the gospel is producing in the people of God. It's a mindset that says, no matter what circumstances, no matter what conditions I find myself in, I need to ask myself, what's my calling before God, and seek to serve the Lord in my calling. The service of those Christians was to be from the heart. So not ultimately for men, but for God. And really, it's the same kind of heavenly submission required of wives to husbands and of children to parents in the previous sections. So you could say some of the same things. You could say that if you were a Christian slave owner in those days, you would be called by God to make that service of your your slaves, to make it as easy and as light as possible, and you might even, as you came into contact with Christian slaves, you might even actually begin to start thinking about whether or not you should have slaves at all. That might actually come about. I'm still hearing a little bit of background noise there. So if I'm seeming a little distracted, that's all it is.
I think it's Lloyd. Lloyd has
Is there?
his microphone on.
Oh, shoot. I'm not an
Oh,
expert at this.
okay. I think
Oh,
if you
I think they're busy in the kitchen.
if you go down to the if you just go down to your microphone down at the bottom there, Lloyd, if you just go down and click on
Maybe I could
that
full screen it.
and you just come down to the very bottom with your cursor, you should find that little microphone symbol. Sorry about that.
I'll keep working on it.
Okay. So ultimately, what Paul is saying to slaves, he's saying to every Christian. To every Christian in union with Jesus Christ, he's saying, remember who you are. That's what we've been saying over and over again. Remember who you are. You're in union with Christ. You're a child of God. You have a heavenly status. Thank you, Lloyd. You have a heavenly status. You are raised up and seated in heavenly places with Jesus Christ, even as you're serving this earthly master. It's a remarkable thing that the gospel lifts us up in this way. In whatever circumstances and conditions we're in, it lifts us up so that we're able to see those circumstances in a totally different light. The gospel simply makes us new creatures. It makes us a part, it makes us part of a new humanity. It transforms every relationship. That's really what we've been seeing in this whole section. It brings something of the atmosphere of heaven into every relationship. And so a Christian really lives like no other human being in this world is able to live, by the grace of God, as the Spirit of God is working the fruit of the Spirit in us. And ultimately, a Christian's living for another world. And that's just very briefly, that's there in verse 8. Because verse 8 is setting before the slave who is living in these circumstances, in this condition of social oppression, it's setting before him the eternal reward. Whatever good that anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. It was actually that view of things that for slaves in America, so often, when you listen to some of the old spirituals that were sung, and actually some of those old spirituals we used to sing as we were picking crops in the fields when I was in the penitentiary. We would sing some of those spirituals. And so often they have a heavenly focus. It's not this world. I have nothing in this world to look forward to. But there's another world that's my home. And you see that's the way that a Christian is enabled by the Spirit to live in this world. So what's the application? Well, it's really far more than just be a good employee and be a hard worker. That's there, and you should draw that out, and you should see that, as Sinclair Ferguson says so well in his book, he brings out the point, if I can find it. What does he say? Well, I'll just paraphrase. He basically Sinclair Ferguson says, you know, whatever you think of your earthly calling, your job in this world, it's not 24 hours a day, 7 days a week that you're in bondage to an employer. It might be 40 hours. You may want more or less hours than you have, but whatever it is, it's really a small thing in comparison to slavery. And you're probably being paid enough to provide for your family, all of those things. And so we have much to be thankful for. But the application really is live in union with Christ and let your love for Him infuse every earthly relationship. Now, briefly, I want to talk about what the gospel says to masters. And that's verse 9. And Paul's primary concern, as I've mentioned, is spiritual, not social. His primary concern is spiritual, not social. However, the spiritual always works itself out into the social, and we're going to see that in a moment. We might ask, well, why doesn't Paul just command slave owners to immediately free their slaves, immediate abolition of slavery, at least for Christians, or you'll face church discipline? Why doesn't he do that? Well, you know, that question actually became a huge question at the time of the Civil War in our own country, and between Northerners and Southerners, and Southerners were saying that the Bible doesn't tell us to free our slaves, and Northerners were saying, well, if you're good Christians, you should see that anyway. You know, so there was this huge debate that was going on, and really a debate that was more a societal debate or a political debate than it was a spiritual debate. Paul is concerned about something far more important than the abolition of slavery. Let me say that again. Paul is concerned about something far more important than the abolition of slavery. He's concerned about something far more important than the transformation of society in this world. Paul's looking forward to a society that's perfect and that has no flaws whatsoever, and a society that needs no transformation. He's looking forward to the world to come, to the life of the world to come. What he's seeking is the transformation of souls through the preaching of the gospel. And its power, the power of the gospel, which is the power of God unto salvation, the power to set people free from the chains of sin and death. That's what Paul is really aiming at. Nevertheless, I want to say this. Paul does address slave owners in a countercultural way as well. Notice what he says. He instructs them. He says, do the same things to them. Give up threatening. That's countercultural. Give up threatening. How else are you going to control your slaves in Roman society? How are you going to do it without force and the threat of force? Well, Paul says, give up threatening. That's countercultural. Show them by your love. Show them by your gentleness what kind of slave owner you are. He instructs them to do the same things to them. To do the same things to them that you are calling upon them to do for you. Of course, there's a difference in the way that works itself out. But he's saying, do the same things. He's saying, do the same things to your slaves that I have just said your slaves are to do to you. Your slaves are to serve you as unto Christ, and you are to rule or to govern in a manner that is consistent with who you are in Christ, in a manner that's consistent with the gospel, just like Christian husbands are to do towards their wives, or Christian parents towards their children. It's to be, this authority is to be exercised in a godly way, not in a harsh and overbearing way. Do the same things to them. Treat them as image bearers. And if they're Christians, go even beyond that. Treat them as brothers and sisters in Christ. Treat them respectfully. Treat them with love, rendering them honor, rendering them the honor that's due to those made in God's image. Now, that definitely translates to those who have any kind of authority in this world that's not a natural parental or the authority of a husband over a wife. This translates in many, many different ways. Perhaps the kind of authority that a Christian magistrate might have as a civil magistrate. How are you going to exercise that authority? Are you going to exercise it lording it over those who you are really called to serve in public trust? There's a lot of ways that this can be applied. The point is that it has practical, real world implications. A Christian slave owner was not to treat his slaves harshly. In fact, and this is, like I said, it's countercultural. In fact, this section is included after instructions for family life. As with husbands, masters of slaves needed to understand that they were accountable to God for their treatment of God's image. There's no partiality. God is not a respecter of persons. He will not take their higher social standing into consideration on the day of judgment. Oh, well, you were a wealthy man. You owned slaves, and therefore, do you think that because of that, God is going to see you any differently, and God is not going to hold you accountable? God is going to hold you accountable, and even more so because you had that position of authority and didn't exercise it in a Christian way. And so really, what we come to in all of this is that the gospel does change society. The gospel really does change society. It's not the main focus of the teaching of this section, but it really needs to be noted that when people are transformed by the power of the resurrection at work in their hearts and lives, they begin to love their neighbor as themselves. In every relationship, it's hinted at in Paul's letter to Philemon concerning the runaway slave Onesimus, whom Paul calls a beloved brother in Christ. That language that he uses toward Onesimus is designed, I think, to strike the very heart of Philemon and to smite his heart, as it were, by the Spirit, to help him to see, well, who is Onesimus? If he's Paul's brother, he must be my brother as well, you see. And so the fundamental concern of the gospel is not to give us blessings that we can only enjoy in this life. Political liberty, economic liberty, or any other kind of earthly liberty. That's not the fundamental concern of the gospel. And anytime we get so caught up in our political liberties and our economic liberties, which are real and which we ought to be concerned about, I'm not saying we shouldn't, but anytime they consume us to the detriment of this fundamental concern, then we've gotten off balance in our Christian life. The fundamental concern of the gospel is that we live in union with Jesus Christ. And so when people have the Spirit of Christ in them, they cannot help but begin to live in a heavenly way in this world. They begin to live a totally different kind of life, a radically transformed kind of life. So that you read the stories of the Christians in Rome who would go out to the highways and the hedges, and they would find the children who had been abandoned because their parents didn't want them. It was perfectly legal for them to just throw their children on the side of the road up to a certain age and let them die, let the elements take them, let the animals come and devour them. Christians would take those abandoned children into their homes rather than allowing them to die. That's the gospel transforming people in such a way that they begin to live differently in society. Slavery was banned in Christian countries for many centuries prior to its resurrection, as it were, in the modern age. So that John Calvin was able even to say there's no such thing as slavery in Europe. In the day of Calvin, he was able to say that. Even in England and America, it was Christians. We have to remember this. It was Christians primarily who opposed the slave trade, who opposed slavery, and eventually brought it to an end in both countries. Now, there were also Christians who disagreed and who thought that the Bible didn't condemn slavery, and therefore it was a social institution that could be justified. And that argument was made. But we have to recognize that it was Christians primarily who brought about the end of slavery in England and later in the United States. So that Ian Hamilton says, slavery is an indefensible evil. Men and women, whatever their color, culture, economic status, are equally made in God's image and likeness. It's kind of like with marriage. Polygamy comes in. Polygamy even comes in into the covenant line. And godly men begin to take more than one wife. And yet, what does Jesus say? That's not how it was in the beginning. Same is true of slavery. The New Testament, Ian Hamilton says, is clear that when men and women come to faith in Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for they are all one in Christ Jesus. Galatians 3:28. It is no surprise that Christians were at the forefront of the movement to abolish slavery in the late 18th century. To treat men and women as if they were commodities to be bought and sold for personal profit and convenience is not only a crime against humanity, but blasphemy against God and deserving of the severest punishment. And really, ultimately, when we come to try to, you know, apply all of this, social change begins in the heart. It doesn't begin with all sorts of external actions and activities and virtue signaling and all of those kinds of things that we see in modern society. But social change begins in the heart. It's why the preaching of the gospel and our own hearing of the gospel, because the preaching of the gospel without the response of faithful hearing, repentant faithful hearing, is just a clanging cymbal. The preaching of the gospel, our own hearing of the gospel, need to be our greatest concern. Whatever our social standing, whatever our influence in this world, we must live in this world as those who belong to the world to come. So, does anybody have any thoughts before I close for tonight? I'm going to go ahead and turn the recording off, just